My name is Craig Jackson. I'm a co-director for this year's Sagan National Colloquium, along with my colleague, Sean McCulloch. I want to tell you a little bit about the National Colloquium first. The National Colloquium was begun at Ohio Wesleyan in 1984. It was later endowed by OWU alumni John and Margaret Sagan. Since its inception, the National Colloquium has served as an annual forum to explore issues of national and international significance from multiple educational angles. The theme of this year's Sagan National Colloquium is Data in Our Lives. Modern technology gives us the ability to generate large amounts of data in ways that were not previously possible, and simultaneously we now possess the computing power to organize and search through that data efficiently. Many different people and organizations are embracing this abundance of data to better market products, to tell richer stories, and to answer questions about ourselves and our society. But there are also legitimate and growing concerns related to the appropriate use of data. The collection of data has numerous privacy, ethical, and legal concerns. Data can also be misused, misunderstood, badly analyzed, leading to incorrect conclusions. This year's colloquium brings together internationally recognized artists, writers, activists, professionals, and scholars from diverse fields to encourage a broad conversation on these and other aspects of our growing importance of data in our lives. I hope that your participation in this conversation leaves you with a sense of both the insight that data science can bring to many difficult and important problems, as well as an understanding of the serious issues that can arise from the overcollection of data. To introduce tonight's speaker, please welcome Scott Kelly from the Department of Zoology.
Thanks. I'm excited to introduce tonight's speaker. It's perhaps fitting that the first speaker would be a scientist. As scientists, our ability to collect data, as Dr. Jackson said, is becoming increasingly easy. We can collect data fast. We can collect lots of it. And in some cases, we can collect so much we don't even know how to store it. We don't know how to necessarily analyze it all the time. And certainly, it's become difficult to interpret it. And so data collection has outpaced our ability to answer the questions that we initially would like to answer from that data. I think this hit home for me as a postdoc when I conducted one experiment, and I spent the next 3 years trying to analyze that one data set. And so data can be collected fast, and the enormity of it can be overwhelming. I worked with many laboratories similar to Dr. Ray's, tonight's speaker, like Dr. Ray's lab, who do things at the intersection of biology and computational mathematics. So I'm excited to introduce Dr. Ray. Dr. Ray received his bachelor's degree from Ohio State University in mathematics, his master's degree also from Ohio State in computer information science, and his Ph.D. in biophysics from Ohio State. He's currently an assistant professor of pediatrics at the Ohio State College of Medicine, and he also holds a faculty position at the Battelle Center for Mathematical Medicine within the Research Institute at Nationwide Children's Hospital. His lab focuses on understanding the disconnect between complex biological systems and currently applied data analysis techniques. His lab also tries to develop new data analysis techniques to help the researcher answer the questions that they're trying to focus on. He's applied these techniques to topics such as modeling protein structure and function, also looking at gene expression analysis, but his research is broad and his interests are varied. And so I think you'll enjoy this evening's talk. So join me in welcoming Dr. Ray. His talk is entitled Seeing Data and Understanding It for a Change.
Thank you. This is on. Excellent. So I am delighted to be here this evening and get the opportunity to talk to you. Very frequently, faculty members try to keep me away from their students because they think I corrupt their poor little minds. So I hope I don't corrupt your minds too much, but I want to talk to you about data, or more importantly, about understanding data, and talk to you about some things that probably you haven't been told about understanding data. These things don't get mentioned too often. Things that I think are really important for you to understand, and hopefully over the course of this evening, I'll be able to convince you that they're important things for you to think about and understand when you are either trying to understand somebody else's data or when you are trying to present data that you have collected or data from your labs, et cetera, and you're trying to communicate what's important about them to other people. The most important thing for you to remember is data is not information. Information is the stuff that gets into your head. It's the knowledge that you can extract from data. It's not the data itself. And this is something that I find that a vast number of people, whether they're students or faculty, simply don't get. They have this impression, I've collected this data, I've got all of this stuff, I'll put it on my poster at a talk. If people want to understand it, they'll understand it. That is hogwash. They won't understand it. They won't understand anything except the information that you extract and abstract for them and provide for them. And what they walk away from your talk, from your poster, from your collection of data with is critically dependent on how you present that data to them and how you use the tools available to you to communicate the information content that is in the data. Now, a corollary to data is not information is big data is not more information. This is a little bit of an aside, but everybody in the world today is all excited about big data and how important big data is going to be in our lives. Let's collect big data. I live in a medical research institute, and I am practically daily talking to people who want to solve some problem with big data. How does the human genome, for example, how does the human genome cause disease or influence disease? Well, we don't know quite how this works, but let's sequence a lot of genomes because that will tell us. And what they mean when they say that is they mean somehow we're going to, by sequencing genomes, we're going to find the differences between people in their genomes, and we're going to be able to use that to analyze how all of these differences work together and cause disease. That sounds great. Until you stop and you think about the fact that there are, give or take, a few million individual differences between different people's genomes. 3 billion-ish nucleotides in the genome. About 2 or 3 million of those have differences in them throughout the population. 2 or 3 million of them. And somebody is imagining we can take sequences from humans, collect all of this information, and it's going to tell us about how these differences work together. 2 or 3 million differences. Does anyone want to take a guess at how many genomes you'd have to collect to actually sample every possible combination? Okay, so I have no idea what the number is because I think computers don't have exponents big enough. By the time you get up to 300 variations, not a few million, 300 variations, the number of possible combinations is about 10 to the 80th. That's the number of electrons in the entire universe. You'd have to sequence as many people as there are electrons in the universe to get one sample of each possible combination of 300 variations. There is no way that we can possibly sequence enough in the entire future of human history, enough people to sample enough people to know how genes and variations in genes interact to cause disease. At least not with this fantasy of we'll just collect a lot of them and it will tell us. The result of just collect a lot of them and it will tell us produces things like this. Not too long ago, several different groups decided, let's find out what the internet knows about images. There are tons of pictures people have posted on the internet. Let's take them all. This is not quite true because they didn't quite take them all. They took a subset of them, a random subset sampling of them, and they threw them into a machine learning algorithm to try and use big data, all of this data that people have collected from photographs, and find out what the internet knew about pictures. What are images of? Theoretically, you could have pictures of terrorists walking into to bus terminals, et cetera, and be able to learn what a terrorist walking into a bus terminal looks like from this. There's tons of interesting things you might learn from this. So they took this vast collection, terabytes and terabytes of image data, and they fed it into a learning algorithm to try and learn something from it. And then they fed it effectively random data. Clouds are nice random data. There's many different size scales in clouds, but they're a non-uniform but stochastically distributed collection of data. And so you feed it to this as a question into a learning algorithm that's taken, for example, a bunch of images, and ask the learning algorithm, oh, great learning algorithm, what do you see in clouds? And it will tell you the things that sort of fit. And the answer is, apparently people take pictures of pets. This is what the internet knows based on image data. Pets. If you were hoping to detect terrorists, it's not going to tell you, apparently. But it can tell you that most pets have two eyes and a nose. That it's got down pat. So, well, when people propose big data solutions to things, you need to stop and think about, is the solution that they're proposing actually something that's grounded in possible reality? And that question, frequently the answer is no. Every now and then the answer is yes, and then it's a great solution. Otherwise, I'll make the argument it's much better to design an experiment to solve the problem that you want to solve than to collect big data and hope that somehow it answers the question that you wanted later someday. But now, as I said, that's sort of an aside. I'm interested in talking about data and the transformation into information, and specifically that transformation, that arrow in the middle. How does this happen? What can you do to make this more effective? My group does a lot of work in a domain that's called visual analytics. It's the science of using your visual system, so the science of using your eyes and the way that your brain processes vision information that's coming in to help you steer an analysis of data, to help you find important features in it, to help you subset it, to help you move through it in some sort of useful fashion and produce analyses. And you can do this right, you can do this wrong. It's a little different as a field from pure visualization, in that pure visualization is mostly the science of how do you make a good picture. Visual analytics is the science of how do you make an interface to data that you can interact with, which frequently involves pictures. And so the content of pictures and what kind of a picture you might have your data draw is important. But it goes beyond just a static representation. And as said in my introduction here, I sort of live in the world of biophysics a little bit, so my personal work is grounded in biophysics, but the general ideas I'm going to talk about are broadly applicable. Typical data analysis question, regardless of what type of data that you might have, is that I've got some sort of a hypothesis. Thing A affects thing B. And I want to know how thing A affects thing B, how this gene affects disease, how this collection of differences in your genome affect disease, how this change in a protein affects whether or not it catalyzes the conversion of sugars into ethanol well for biofuels. Tons of these kinds of things involve, excuse me, I've got a collection of different individuals. They all have small variations, and I'd like to analyze them. At one level, this is pretty easy. You can use statistical techniques like mutual information, joint relative entropy. There are tons of ways of analyzing thing A affects thing B. But what if it's not simply thing A affects thing B? As I was saying earlier, in your genome, you have a few million places where there are differences in it. They don't act individually. In very, very few cases does one of those particular variations in your genome make a change that says you're going to have this disease or you're going to have big feet or what have you. It's a collection of them and interactions between them. And so if you've got interacting terms in your data, if you have places where your where features in your data talk to each other in a sense, all of a sudden it becomes very difficult to write simple solutions like mutual information. This thing shares a lot of information content with that thing. Those solutions stop being ideal solutions. So the classical answer is that you write down a regression equation for all of the variables that you think might interact. You solve for the coefficients of the regression equation. But that requires that you have a hypothesis about how what features interact. And remember, the number of hypotheses, let's talk about your genomes again, 2 million variables, every possible combination of them. How long will it take you to write down all of the possible combinations of regression equations to solve for which one works best? The answer is a very long time, longer than the universe is going to be around, and you'd run out of electrons to write them on. So, again, visual analytics, my proposal is use your brain and your eyes, because they've been built to solve a lot of these kinds of problems in some pretty surprising fashions. And the reason that you can get away with this is because there are two different sorts of representations of information that you can get into your head. You can get into your head what are called conventional representations, and you can get into your head what are called sensory representations. Conventional representations are things like numerals. The numerals 1, 2, 3 don't mean 1, 2, 3 to your brain until you've taught your brain this symbol means 1, this symbol means 2, etc. There's nothing sensory about it. There's nothing innate about the fact that 1 is represents a single thing and 3 represents 3 things. On the other hand, the spots on dominoes, the little toys with dots on them, don't know if anyone plays with dominoes anymore. The spots on dominoes are a sensory representation. The number of dots represents how many. 3 dots means 3, 1 dot means 1. This is a representation that is innate to the way that your brain works rather than a thing that you have to train your brain to do. There are some big advantages to conventional representations, but sensory representations have some pretty neat features to them as well. So this is an audience participation talk. We're going to do a little pre-attentive task test. Up here in this block are going to flash a collection of blue and or red circles. And your job is to say yes or no to whether there's a red circle amongst the blue circles. They're just going to flash up there and disappear. So, okay, the neat thing about that is it takes you unit time, the same amount of time, to analyze that image, no matter how complex it gets. There are a couple caveats to that. The size of the objects has to be about the same, et cetera. But it doesn't matter how many of them that I put in an area, as long as it subtends the same amount of your visual area, as long as the features are the same size. It takes the exact same amount of time to analyze them, no matter how many are there. If I were to put them up in some other sort of representation, if I were to put them up in a conventional representation, you'd actually have to read each and every one of them to answer that question. We can take advantage of that, and we'll come back to how we can take advantage of it later. Now, not everything about sensory representations is good, or at least you have to be aware of everything if you want to use them. Not everything lends itself to being a positive influence to understanding if you don't treat it carefully. So, for example, will everybody buy the argument that these are, whatever this data is that I'm plotting here, that this is the same data plotted in 4 different columns? Everybody believe that they're the same? Okay. Let me commit the cardinal sin of data visualization and use a PowerPoint background behind my data. Do you still believe they're the same? You believe they're the same? You're better at ignoring your visual systems cues than most people then. Most people will see this as there being some sort of a break between dark stuff and light stuff here and there and there and there. They look different now that they have a background behind them. And it's because of the way that your visual system processes this kind of information. It determines what gray is, a middle tone value, based on its immediate surroundings. Your visual system, despite what you may think, has no context whatsoever for this is medium gray, other than the stuff that it is immediately surrounding it. So your brain says, that's the same shade as that is the same shade as that is the same shade as that. And it's very hard to convince your brain not to believe that those have the same shade at different locations now instead of all at the same location. You have to be careful about this kind of thing when you're presenting data, or you can easily mislead people into believing that four different samples that are the same are different just by choosing a different background. And I'm not lying if I put those on my chart and say, I want to convince somebody that I've got an effect happening as I change the concentration of some enzyme in my protein system. An effect happens and more and more and more of it accumulates. I'm not really lying if I put that data up there. I'm only lying in what I'm interpreting to people. So the kind of thing you have to watch out for. Another example of actually the same phenomenon. What's the color of the little cross section in the middle of these blocks here? Bluish, greenish, is that what I'm hearing? Some people say purple. How about this one? Yellow? Raise your hand when you decide that you were wrong. They're the same color. The same effect happens with color contrast as happens with black to white grayscale gradients. Your notion of what is white is just as subjective as your notion of what is gray. The color white is a color that your visual system averages out of all of the other stuff. Because those pictures had backgrounds that were dominated by either blue on one side or yellow on the other side, your visual system interprets those backgrounds as being grayish, trending towards white. And as a result, this thing that is gray in the middle pushes in the opposite direction on the color wheel. So the background, what should be the center of the color wheel, gets shifted off to the blue side. That shifts the thing that should be gray over, and you interpret it as having a color when it really doesn't. This doesn't just happen in terms of simple optical illusions like that, but your understanding of what you see probably isn't quite what it is that you see in other fashions as well. For example, there's a phenomenon that is called inattention blindness. Everybody has the impression that they see stuff continuously around them, that their impression of their environment, their impression of data that they're looking at, their impression of what they're looking at is a continuous stream of data, and that they remember images. The reality is that's not true. What you remember is the story that you told yourself about the images that you were looking at. As soon as that image goes away, your ability to remember what was in it is only as good as what you remember of the story that you told yourself, not the image itself. So for example, we'll show a brief little movie here. It's just two frames. It blips from one frame to the other frame and back again between the two of them. Raise your hand when you can identify something that's different between the two frames. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay. Let me speed that up a little bit for you. Amazingly easier when there's no blank in between them, because when there's no blank, you actually can remember the image. This isn't important just for the purposes of little movies like this. This is important for the purposes of things like presenting the difference between experimental result A and experimental result B. If you put experimental result A up in one graph and experimental result B up in another graph, people have to look away from A to look at B. What they remember from A is the story they told themselves, not the picture. What they can compare between result A and B is the story. It's very rare when people don't make little mistakes in their figures, like a difference in line weight or a different font size, etc. How many people, when they were looking at this, noticed the feet moving and then didn't see anything else? Didn't notice the toy disappearing, or noticed the fin moving and didn't notice anything else? Once you notice some little difference between figure A and figure B, it becomes even harder to notice the difference that you actually intended them to notice, because they're fixated on the one thing in the story that they caught. And that turns out to be actually a real problem. How many people would agree with the argument, if I'm going to show you some data or some information, I should show you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, only the data. Don't embellish, don't change it. Show it to me as it is with no modifications. Yeah, you know that's a trick question, but what is that? Close. Anybody tell what it is? This is all of my data. Now I'm going to add stuff to it that is not part of the data. Now can you tell me what it is? I always think I'm going to give it away by repeatedly saying data while I'm showing that up there. Your visual system needs the noise, this stuff in front, to see the information. That's sort of an interesting trick. It needs garbage added to the picture before you can interpret the data. When somebody tells you just show the data, they don't really understand how people's brains work. Sometimes you have to help lead them to the information. In this case, this happens, I think, most people think, because our visual systems grew up in the African savanna trying not to get eaten by tigers, et cetera, and we've got to be able to detect the tiger that's hiding behind the plants and stuff. So occluding garbage in front, we can see through, and we can make visual hypotheses about how things are connected when they are partially hidden, when we can see the stuff that's hiding them. We can't do that when we don't have that stuff in front. Our visual system just wasn't evolved to deal with that. Now, does this have to do with scientific data at all? The answer is resoundingly yes. This is a plot from one of my collaborators. This is data about how middle ear infections occur, specifically middle ear infections that are induced to attempt to study middle ear infections in chinchillas, because we use chinchillas as the model organism. We've got some bits and pieces here. You don't have to pay attention to the specifics. Just know that each of these lines plots the concentration of either a virus or a bacteria in different anatomic components in a chinchilla. The bluish lines are bacterial infection, the reddish warm-colored lines are viral infection. And this is the graph that killed. Based on the data from this, they were very excited about the results that they got. They made an experimental vaccine, a nasal inhaler vaccine, shot it up kids' nose, it gave them encephalitis, and they died. Because they didn't pay attention to the data here, because it suffers from problems that I just showed you on the previous handful of slides. How many people can tell me, despite the fact that was just up there for 2 or 3 minutes, whether or not there's an anatomic component where the viral infection is still high at the end of the time course? Anybody? The red ones, yes. And you remember that there is one? You told yourself the right story. You would have saved children. Good job. Yes, there is. But the problem with that graph is you don't interpret lines as time course data. Time exists as something that happens over time for you, not something that happens over space. You interpret lines as trajectories. And so it's very difficult to remember what happens in a slot of the time course. You remember the trajectories from data. So I tried to show them their data in a fashion, unfortunately, after the fact, that was a little bit more amenable to understanding the data and seeing what they should have seen. So we took chinchillas, or, well, chinchilla skulls, and soaked them in a dye to dye them a dark color, and then embedded them in a white wax and stuck them on a little milling machine in my office because we didn't want to get stuff all over the lab, and milled off a slice at a time of chinchilla head, and it took a photograph of it. You can see the end of the camera lens there. It blew this stuff that looks kind of like confetti, coconut, whatever they call that stuff, coconut strand stuff, all over my office. It was like a little Christmas drifts of it everywhere for weeks. People would walk into my office and pick up handfuls and stuff it up their nose. They'd say, what is that, Will? I'd say, that's ground up chinchilla brains. And they'd say, no, really, what is it? I'd say, no, really, that's ground up chinchilla brains. And then they'd run off and puke. So moral of the story, if you come to my office, don't stick things up your nose before asking what they are. But the point of all this is we built this into an anatomic model of the chinchilla, and we cast that data, the graph data, into the anatomic model so that we could show both where the anatomy was and the time course of the infection in a fashion that is amenable to understanding time courses. So these are the anatomic components that were represented. The naso turbinates where air is filtered, the ethmoid shelf that splits air for smelling from air for breathing, the ethmoid turbinates where smelling happens, the nasopharynx where the air is transferred from the nasal passages into the throat, the eustachian tubes that lead back to the ears, and we did not put the middle ears on there. But this is the very same data as we showed before, only this is shown as an animation. This is data, a representation of data that is innately time-based to the way that your brain understands things. Reddish things, again, are viral infection. Greenish things are the bacterial infection. We'll let this play out. The very same quantitative data. We just mapped it to the rate of creation or destruction of the little particles that are emitted. So, is there anyone who can't tell me now whether there was an anatomic component that still had a viral infection at the end of that? Nobody missed it that time? Yeah. So the story tells itself in this case, rather than you having to tell yourself the story. If you didn't notice the right story before, you didn't remember it. This time, you remember the story because the story was told to you. If you can capitalize on that, this can be a really powerful way of conveying the right data to the audience that you want to convey it to. And as I said, that previous graph, literally people died as a result of not understanding that, of the scientists not understanding that data. If they had known that this component retains a viral infection for a long time, they would not have used that particular way of delivering the vaccine. The problem is this anatomic component, there's a window between the ethmoid turbinates and your brain. There's no bone in between. There's a piece of skull that isn't there so that your brain can directly sense the information from the nerves in your nose. That part of your nasal passages to have a viral infection risks having the viral infection make it into the membrane that surrounds the brain. And once that happens, then that swells up. It causes a overabundance of fluid inside the brain cavity. Bad things happen. So it is important to pay attention to how data is represented and whether the representation is ideal. So to get close to how we might use some of this to address some of these questions, I said big data is kind of a fantasy in many cases. Just want to briefly talk about conventional representations. Excuse me. And as I said, conventional representations, they're hard to understand. You have to read them. You have to parse the data and understand it, because it doesn't lend itself to being something that is understood by your senses. It's something that you have to understand by reading and thinking effectively. So does anyone see an obvious trend to the numbers here? It's because you lose all of this pre-attentive and hardwired processing. If we plot it in even the most simple visualization, suddenly it's pretty easy to see, same numbers, that there is, in fact, a trend. You can understand the sensory representation better. Can we do that for hypotheses, for this thing affects that thing? One of the best ways to do that right now, conventional representation, is a thing called a contingency table, where we plot out thing A possibilities and thing B possibilities, and we put in the cells between them the co-occurrences. So this says, if you're not familiar with contingency tables, that when thing A, or in this case thing I, is a T, thing J is an A four times. When it's an A in thing I, it's an A in thing J two times, et cetera. You just read the possible combinations. There are 10 of each of them, so thing A occurs 10 times in I, thing A occurs 10 times in J, and they occur 40 times total in each of them. That's how you read one of these. But you've got to parse them all. If you want to do this with all of the interactions of several million things, you've got several million rows and columns, and you've got several million of those, because you are talking about combinations, and this only talks about pairs. So you've got millions upon millions of millions by millions data sets that you've got to follow in a conventional representation. That gets tedious and or runs out of electrons. We can do a few things to simplify this. We can change it from the quantity to whether or not there's an over-expectation or an under-expectation. So if we swap this to T occurs 1.5 times more frequently than we would expect if they were independent, A occurs half a time less than we would occur or expect, we can simplify it, but it still doesn't reduce the volume of data. We can throw away all of the ones that are not interesting, put some sort of threshold on it, and only look at ones that pass some threshold test. I'll point out this is already cheating because it's using visual effects to lead your eye to the most important things, but you're still overwhelmed with this huge quantity of data that you have to understand via conventional means. If we use some of the science I was talking about previously, visualization as a way of interpreting data, we can change this to sensory representations. And we can represent possibilities for I and possibilities for J in a visual fashion. Not very exciting so far. But we can represent co-occurrences between them by weighted lines. So a weighted line between, for example, G and C here says there's a lot of times that G occurs and C occurs. There are some times, but not nearly as many, that T occurs and G occurs, et cetera. Suddenly, this is a sensory representation. I can show you this picture, and you can understand it without having to read the numbers. Why is that important? Because now I can show it to you as many times as I wanted. Remember, sensory representations, I can pack as much information into as fits, and you can interpret it in unit time. So if this is a column from that representation and this is a column, the fact that there are no lines between them tells you that nothing interesting is happening. Here's something interesting happening between a position in this column and a position over there, but that's, you know, largely nothing's happening in that data set. Doesn't matter what the data set is, don't worry about that. This one you can tell there's a lot happening, and it has a very distinct pattern. It doesn't even look vaguely random to you. There's something important happening. You didn't have to look at, this would be, by the way, 200 tables with 200 contingency tables, each of which is 16 stacked contingency tables deep, to read this by reading the numbers. You can see all of it in one picture. So let's perform an experiment. I said roughly 300 is where you run out of electrons in the universe to map all of the possible combinations. Well, 300 is where you would, interacting variables is where you run out of the ability to map all the possible combinations, but of course all the possible combinations aren't there. You've got to write down the regression equations for all of them to discover that they aren't there if you're going to do it that way. But what if we just look at the ones that are there? So I'm going to put up a picture here, and this is protein data. You don't need to know what it is. All that you need to know is it's a big circular picture, and your job is to find something in it that you think is interesting. Anything, up to you. Anything in it that you think is interesting other than details of the symbols around the edge, because they mean something I'm not going to talk to you about. Features of the stuff going on in the interior that you think are interesting. Everybody have something that they think is a feature that they liked? Now, tell me, raise your hand when the feature that, when anything that's in the, or not anything, when the stuff in the area of the feature that you're interested in disappears. Okay, just about everybody has their hand up by this point in time, which is appropriate. The successive pictures that I showed you were increasing the statistical stringency of what it took to appear in the circle. At this point, we've got a p-value now. I was just telling my inviters that p-values are bunk, but they're the best thing we've got today. We're looking at things that pass a p-value stringency test. That means they would happen randomly of 0.001 or less than 1 in 1,000 times that we would see these from the data, that you would see those edges appearing. The p-value for what you looked at when you made your decision is 0.1, which is to say that 1 in 10 times, that's garbage. 1 in 10 times, the stuff up there is garbage. Any statistician would tell you, get out of the room, come back when you have more data. And multiple hypothesis correction, 10 to the 80th multiplier, give or take. Nobody should believe this data at all. However, I guarantee you, some people picked that region, right? Who picked this batch here? This batch over here? Nobody picked that. This batch going that way, okay? Who's the joker who picked the hole? There's always someone who picks the hole. Thank you. So it's not wrong to pick the hole. It's just you focused on a variety of feature that's different than everybody else. This picture is a picture of coevolution in a protein. It's a particular protein. It's all of the positions in the protein. Proteins are a chain of amino acids. It's the chain of amino acids from one end to the other laid out around a circle. And if ignore the colors, there's a bunch of details that my graduate student invented. It's this residue in the protein over here changes when that residue changes throughout evolutionary history. We've been trying to use this data for two decades to infer this position in the protein is touching that position in the protein. Because if this one always changes when that one changes, obviously they must be touching. It turns out that's wrong. When this one always changes, when that one changes, they're not always touching. That picture looks much more like what I showed you at the end, the very sparse picture. The very few things are actually touching from these co-evolving residues. Or rather, from the most frequently co-evolving. These signals that are all garbage signals, we just established that, p-value of 0.1 without correction for the 10 to the 80th hypotheses that we're looking at. Despite the fact that's garbage, you just solved a protein structural question that there is no computational algorithm to solve today. This stuff is touching. This stuff is touching. This stuff is touching. That stuff is touching. That stuff is touching. These are all contacts. You solved them in your head. You solved them in your head because any computational approach to this goes linearly through those 2 to the 80th possible things and says, how strong is this one? How strong is that one? And tries to rank order them. And then it makes some decision, I've got to stop now because 2 to the 80th is way too big a number for me to count to. So I'm going to take the top 10 or the top 20 or the top 500 and it chops it off at the top 10 or 20 or 500 and the top 10 or 20 or 500 aren't where structural contacts are. The ones that are the top 10 or 20 or 500 are the ones that were in that final picture that I went to. Let's back up here to it real quickly. That one. That's the top of the list, and all of the ones that you picked, almost, have vanished off of here because they don't have to do with structure. The ones that have to do with structure, it turns out, are ones that occur only occasionally, not ones that always occur. You see them as clouds of there's something going on here because this happens 1 in 10 times, and that happens 1 in 5 times, and that happens 1 in 20 times. And all of these things that happen occasionally happen in a pattern, and your brain can analyze those patterns in unit time. A computer can't. No algorithm can analyze the patterns in unit time the way that your visual system can. You pick up on the patterns that exist, and therefore you can solve the problem in a fashion that no computer can. This is the strength that comes out of understanding how to represent data to actually extract meaningful information out of it, even if it's potentially big data. And with that, I'll close, and if you have questions, I would love to entertain them. And if you walk away with this from this with nothing else, hopefully you walk away with a healthy dose of skepticism with respect to whether a solution that somebody proposes to you is going to answer the question if they don't have a good plan for how to accomplish that. If they don't, this could all look like cats and dogs instead. Thank you.
If you have a question, go ahead and raise your hand and one of us will come and bring a mic. Turn on.
So I'm confused. When should I use a table and when should I use a figure? Is there an easy way to always represent your data?
I don't think I could say that there is a one-shot solution that solves every problem. I would only use a table if I wanted to provide the original data for somebody else to analyze, though. If I want to provide understanding if I want to provide information, I would always use some figure way of representing the data so that I can lead them to the important conclusions that that are there to see, rather than potentially arbitrary things that they might focus on. But, of course, extracting the data back out of this, if somebody else has another idea about how to analyze it, extracting the data back out of this is next to impossible. So in terms of providing the data so that they can take it further, tables are great. In terms of providing understanding, tables are pretty awful.
Hi, thank you for the talk. So my question is, with conventional representations, it's usually, there is some standard behind it. So we have some standardized way of representing it. So do you think that with sensory representations, there's a need to standardize them, or is it dependent on how we need to analyze the data?
So yes and no. There are already a lot of standards, sort of, so to say, about sensory representations, typical ways that data is represented. And even just your normal scatter plot is a sensory representation, and it's a fairly conventional, but I don't mean conventional, way of representing a collection of XY data, two variable data. Yes, in that there are typically best ways to represent data. It would be helpful to identify this particular variety of data lives in this representation better than any other, and to develop standards of that variety. No, in the context of there's already been quite a lot of stuff that has been done to develop sensory representations where they did not pay attention to what works well and what works poorly. And so the standards that are used are actually quite bad. If you have ever have anything to do with microarray data or gene expression data in the biological sciences, you will discover that as a standard, a sensory representation that is used very frequently is a variety of representation called a heat map. It represents sort of this same interaction, thing A interacts with thing B this strongly data, only as a grid with lit up or not lit up cells in it. And you look at that and you pick out regions with lots of something interesting happening. The problem with that is that you can mutate the matrix effectively and still have the same matrix. Matrix transformations allow you to say, swap those two columns, swap those two, swap these rows. So the fact that you don't see a pattern doesn't mean that there isn't one. It just means that potentially the order of the columns isn't right. I'm fudging on the story just slightly with respect to this, but if you go back to the very first paper on microarrays, a fellow named Michael Eisen in 1997 made the very first microarray, and the clustering routine and representation that he used has become the standard sensory conventional representation. In the figure legend, for the very first time this was ever used for microarrays, it says, "This is stupid, never do it again." The only reason I'm doing this is to show you that there are patterns. There has to be a better way to represent them than this. Everybody still uses that same stupid way to do it because that's what appeared in the first paper. So, standards come into existence. That doesn't mean they're the right standards. Yes?
Hi. What you're mentioning about how like the graph that got all those kids killed and stuff like that, would it be wise to show like different interpretations of the graph, but kind of like in pictures, kind of like what you did with like the kid with the very smaller kid, like just show different interpretation, like the graph, it's the same thing, but show more visual interpretations. So like, oh, okay.
So yes. For a couple reasons. One of them is it's a little bit of a cheat for me to say that that animation shows that feature, and they wouldn't have, you know, kids wouldn't have died if they'd used the animation. That, in fact, is true. But there are other things that are harder to see in it. The graph doesn't make the time course interpretation easy to understand because we don't understand time as lines. We understand time as a bunch of stuff that happened right now, and then a bunch of stuff that happened now. We don't understand that as trajectories. And when we show trajectories, we understand them as this thing moved in some fashion. Our sensory interpretation of a line is a trajectory. That's not the same thing as time course data and data that exists now. So the graph is better for some things. It's worse for understanding the time course data. There are many other representations that could be used that would highlight other features of the data. I would advocate for using as many different representations as possible to look at the data so that you don't miss features, because maybe the feature isn't time course or trajectory-like. Maybe the important thing for you to notice has some other characteristic, and a different representation would be a better match for our sensory understanding of that feature. The more different, completely different choices you make, the more opportunities you have to notice those things, and so the better the understanding you should walk away with.
Thank you for the talk. It's very interesting. I was wondering, especially with this last figure, I'm thinking about the connection between the formal and conventional statistical analysis, which I totally understand. The p-value is arbitrary. There are limitations to statistical tests. But in certain scientific fields, those tests are sort of the standard. And if you haven't applied them to your data, you know, it's more difficult to get that data out into a public forum. So is your goal to have the visual representation eventually just replace the analysis, or are you often laboring to have a really great representation and then match it to an appropriate analysis?
So more the latter. I would not argue for trying to replace a competent statistical analysis. But the thing that this highlights is that the naive analysis that we all thought was the right analysis, and I will cop to this, I spent 15 years in the crop of people doing it the wrong way, making the very same assumptions and developing better and better statistical approaches. And this, I wasn't kidding. Since 1995, we've been doing this very same thing. We've been analyzing coevolution in proteins and looking at this position changes when that position changes, and assuming that we could infer this position was near that position. Every so many years, 5 or 6 years, another batch of papers comes out. It invents new statistical methods, finds the most strongly co-evolving things. How do we eject phylogeny? How do we correct for genetic drift over, you know, different rates of genetic drift over different periods of evolution, et cetera? And they get the list of the things that make the strongest co-evolving have the highest, lowest, smallest p-values. And universally, 60% of those, no matter how good we get it at that statistic, only 60% of them are actually in contact with each other. And the reason is actually because it's not the ones that are that co-evolve the most frequently. The ones that co-evolve the most frequently because nature needs them to co-evolve. Nature, I suspect that the majority of you aren't biologists, but for those who are and for those who aren't, nature doesn't give a hoot about structure, about whether this amino acid is close to that amino acid. It cares whether the protein works. It cares whether it's functional. And if the organism can find a way to make it functional without maintaining the same structure, nature couldn't possibly care less. That's acceptable. The only time that nature has this changes and that's gotta change is when it's an absolute functional requirement. So the things that you see at the top of the list, the things that are the most stringent co-evolvers, the best p-values, are things that have to do with function, not with structure. Nature likes options for structure. This changes, that can fix it, that can fix it, that can fix it. 57 different things can repair this, but as a result, it'll never have a good p-value. So it turns out that your brain can pick up these clouds of things where there's a bunch of low p-values, poor p-values, that sort of occur in the same place and sort of occur with a pattern to them. And your brain says, aha, there's something going on there. Now I can turn around and I can write a better statistical test for there's something going on there. But I've got, if I want to have a statistic for it, I've got to go back and write a statistical test for whatever that something going on is. And that's what the visual analytic component of this is. This is an iterative process. We make pictures, we learn from the pictures, we develop better statistics for how to approach the problem, we make better pictures, we repeat through this process.
I have a quick question. Well, hopefully it's quick, but you mentioned the fact that, you know, there's no algorithm necessarily that can take the conventional data or the way the data is conventionally represented, say in this picture, and churn through and get everything. There's just too much there. And yet here you have a computer algorithm that produces an image that we can infer a lot from. Can you talk about maybe how this algorithm actually works in a way that we can understand?
So the algorithm that produces the picture?
Yes.
So the picture is actually tremendously simple. I don't know whether this is maybe admitting to being an idiot here. The picture is nothing but, again, with positions in the protein. There's some data in columns here. If you remember, I had contingency table columns, they're all actually going into the screen here. So these are not individual points. These are columns of 20 different amino acid possibilities. And the lines are actually drawn between a position on one of those columns to some particular position on another column. That's irrelevant for the purposes of understanding that you can see something's going on here. But it turns out that it's really useful for our purposes as biophysicists to try to analyze the data. The picture itself is simply generated by taking in literally this contingency table data. This column has this particular distribution of amino acids, however many proteins I threw into this. In this case, you'd be amazed, there are only 20 proteins that you're making this, 20 individual proteins that you're making these decisions from. This is hardly any data, actually, total. But, you know, so for example, you know, you can't really see the detail here. Let me blip back a couple. Maybe we can talk through one where it's easier to see. Come on. So we represent in any column the proportion of the population that is a particular symbol by the size of the circle in it, the size of a ball, effectively. So this says there's an equal population of A's, T's, G's, and C's. This is nucleotide data. A's, T's, G's, and C's in position I, 25% of each of them. The same thing in J. And then we draw in lines for overpopulation and underpopulation. If these were independent, we would expect the exact same number of individuals that started in A to end up in A as T, as G, as C. So we'd expect 25% of the ones that were in A to end up in A, 25% to end up in T, 25% to end up in G, 25% to end up in T. We represent over and under populations of them rather than literally what happens. So in this case, what this is telling you is that there's an overpopulation that start in A. If they're independent, there's an overpopulation of them that start in A that end up in T. Something's going on between A and T. We don't bother to throw in the rest of the lines because they're within the expected variation in the data. And there's no reason to show us what's expected. The only thing we want to know about is what's unexpected. So there's an overpopulation of A's that become T's, an overpopulation of T's that become A's, a much smaller overpopulation of T's that become G's. a small overpopulation of G's that become T's, a large overpopulation of G's that become C's, and C's that become G's. So that really, that's all that we do, is we calculate these overpopulations and underpopulations. It's the difference between what would occur in the cell if the data were independent based on the marginals, what you'd predict to occur in a contingency table cell, and what's actually in the cell. And this is only showing positive differences. We also show negative differences, so if there's an underpopulation in a cell as well. But we just build the picture by drawing these balls that represent populations and drawing that represent populations of particular symbols in a column, and then drawing lines that represent overpopulations or underpopulations of shared positions between them. In this case, this is a Tata box promoters in the bacteria, actually in archaebacteria. And it's the distribution of nucleotides starting 18 positions before the start site in bacteria. 18 positions before the start site, there's a large population of C's, yellow is C, there's a very few G's, no T's, T's are blue, and a very few A's, A's are red. The next position closer to the start site is almost all, well, it's all A's and G's with more A's than G's. And, you know, we walk around, we can read each of the columns, and there's next to no dependencies between them. There's a small negative dependency between being a C 18 away, position 18 is the last position before, being a C 18 upstream and being a T 15, no, 5 upstream or something like that. And there's another small underpopulation back there, but that's next to empty. There's no interactions in the data. None of the positions depend on other positions. The entire signature of that region has to do with the sequence rather than having to do with dependencies. This is a different nucleotide motif out of the bacteria, and it is rife with dependencies. It looks like the sequence says I could be a G or a C, or I don't really care, almost the same number of A's, T's, G's, and C's, then I could be a G or a C, et cetera. It looks like we can read propensities off of it here. But in fact, what's important is the patterns. If this one is a T, that one has to be an A. If this one's a G, that one has to be a C, and vice versa. This is a region of the genome where there's a huge amount of dependency between the positions, where one position's, the symbol seen in one position dictates what symbol is seen in another position, and the signature has almost nothing to do with the observed propensities in the positions. It has to do with the dependencies between them. So the difference between a place where there are dependencies and a place where there aren't dependencies is pretty dramatic in this type of representation.
Any last questions? Well, then join me in thanking our speaker.